Today we continue our journey through this Lenten season. And for many of us, as we stated before, during this time of Lent, we give up things for 40 days. And by doing so, it can be very beneficial to us and to our life moving forward. By giving up certain things, we strengthen our relationship with God and open up for the potential of a better life. And in any relationship we have, whether it's with God or with our spouse or with our friends or family, if we give up certain things when we're in this relationship, the relationship begins to strengthen. And like I said before, there may be nothing at all wrong with your life now, and it may be good. Your relationships with God and everyone else may be good or fine with you right now. However, if we had to choose between good and better, I think most of us, wouldn't we want better? Wouldn't we want to choose better? So each week we've been looking at intangible things that if we give them up for 40 days, we could possibly change our life for the better. And these are things God wants us to give up. Not just for 40 days, but maybe forever. And we began this sermon series by looking at control and giving up control. And last week we looked at giving up unreasonable expectations. And today, I believe, is the toughest of them all. Because if we look at giving something up, if I said we need to give this up, most of us, me included, would say, hey, look, that's not me. That's just not me. You know me. That's not me. When I say today we're going to look at giving up superiority, being superior, and I would say most of us do we ever look at ourselves as being superior to others? I mean, most of us look at ourselves on the humble side of the spectrum. But as you will see, and I hope and I pray that we realize that it's not as easily defined as we think it is. And so we begin with a story about Jesus. It's one that we've probably heard before. It's not a complicated story or a parable, but it's an encounter with Jesus and a woman at a well. And as I read this encounter, I want to ask you to do something out of the ordinary sermon routine. As I read this story uninterrupted, I want you to see which character in this story that you most identify with. Which person best describes you? Or the person or character you could say, that's me. That's me. That's my story. So let us listen this morning with inquisitive ears. But it's important to note when this story takes place. It's early in Jesus' ministry. And he and his disciples have been traveling around, gaining popularity, just after Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist. And Jesus' ministry movement was gaining steam. And as you can imagine, it displeased the leaders of the church, the Pharisees. You see, this new way of life, this new way of looking at God and relating to God was upsetting the church leaders. So they began to put pressure on Jesus. They began to put spies in the crowd. They began to try to trick him with different questions. So Jesus and his disciples leave Judea and were headed back to Galilee, which was Jesus' hometown. And along the way, they traveled through Samaria. And as you know, Jews despise the Samaritans, and the Samaritans despise the Jews. But it's curious to know that the scripture states that Jesus had to go through Samaria. And however, if you know geography, it was not a direct journey from Judea to Galilee. It was, simply put, it would be like me saying, I need to go to Mount Vernon, but I'm going to go through Salem to go to Mount Vernon. It just doesn't make sense. But Jesus says, I have to go through Samaria. So if you would join me in the fourth chapter of the Gospel of John, beginning with the fifth verse. And again, I'm going to read this uninterrupted to see where you find yourself in this story. Now he had gone, he had to go through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground where Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus tried, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink?" For the Jews did not associate with Samaritans. Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is asking for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and that well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here and draw water." Jesus told her, "Go call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You're right, and when you say you have no husband, the fact is you have had five husbands, and the man you have is not your husband, and what you have just said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, I can see that you're a prophet. Your ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that place where you must worship in Jerusalem." "Woman," the Jesus replied, "believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on the mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in the truth, for they are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. See, God is Spirit, and his worshipers must worship in the Spirit and in the truth." The woman said, "I know that Messiah is coming, and when he comes, he will explain everything to us." And Jesus declared, "I, the one speaking to you, I am he." And just then the disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking to a woman. But no one said, "What do you want?" or "Why are you talking to her?" Then, leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, "Come and see this man who told me everything I did. Could he be the Messiah?" They came out of the town and made their way toward him. And meanwhile, his disciples urged him, "Rabbi, eat something." But he said to them, I have food to eat that you know nothing about." And then his disciples said to each other, "Could someone have brought him food?" "My food," said Jesus, "is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work." "Don't you have a saying, it's still 4 months until the harvest, and I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields, they're ripe for the harvest? I mean, even now the one who reaps draws a wage and harvests a crop for eternal life, so that the sower and the reaper may be glad together. Thus the saying, 'One sows, the other reaps,' is true. I sent you to reap what you have not worked for. Others have done the hard work, and you have reaped the benefits of their labor." Now many of the Samaritans from the town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. "He told me everything I ever did," she said. So when the Samaritans came to him, they urged him to stay with them. And he stayed for 2 days. And because of his words, many more became believers. They said to the woman, We no longer believe just because of what you said. Now we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this man really is the Savior of the world." You see, the story begins by Jesus breaking all social conventions by even speaking to a woman in public. A man, much less a Jewish man, much less a religious man, would not dare talk to an unaccompanied woman. A Samaritan, no less, a Samaritan woman alone, whose life was a mess, this would surely mess up Jesus' reputation. Surely it would mess up Jesus' popularity. It surely wouldn't sit well with the people in the church that were watching him, but there it is. At the well of Jacob, a holistic, holy place, Jesus brings a message of grace and freedom. And Jesus knew that in her humility, she would hear this message of grace and of freedom, and she would respond. And while the religious leaders were too busy, or they thought they were just too self-important to hear God's message of grace and freedom, this woman did. And it reminds us that God doesn't care about artificial lines that we draw to make ourselves feel superior over others. And feeling superior over others is not an outright, blatant thing. It's not. However, if we've ever declared statements, either out loud or in our mind or in our soul, if we've ever declared statements of like, I know better than them what is best for the church. If you've ever said it's like, I know how you feel. We've ever said things like, you know what? You shouldn't be so reckless. We've ever said things, you know, you just really need to get your heart right with Jesus. Even if it comes from the Pope. If we've ever said, you know what, I know what's best for you. Or if we've even said out loud in our souls, you know what, I know how you feel. And you should feel blank. You fill it in. If we've ever vocalized those thoughts or had those thoughts, we've positioned ourselves superior over the person that God has created. If you don't believe me at all, look at our political system. Every Democrat thinks that they are better than the Republicans. And every Republican believes they are superior over the Democrats. And you hear these statements over and over and over again. And they say, well, you can vote. You can vote for this person fill in the blank because they're better than this person. But if you're able to let go of statuses, if you're able to let go of symbols, if you're able to let go of entitlements or judgmental attitudes, you too can hear Jesus' call more clearly, and you can respond more faithfully. So who do you identify with in this story? Maybe you identify with the woman at the well. I mean, this woman who, because of her past, just does not fit in anywhere. She's rejected. She's nobody. She's ashamed to be around other people. So she goes to this well during the hottest part of the day when she knows that no one else will be there. No one. She's embarrassed as her life has just beaten her down. She's forgotten by those in her family and by those in her community. She's been forgotten and thrown away by those in the church. But she's open to any sign of kindness and any validation of who she is. And when life has beaten her down to the lowest, when she felt like no one cared, Jesus goes out of his way to meet her. Out of his way to meet her. But maybe you can identify with the disciples. I mean, you see the disciples? I mean, they're not major in this story. You see, they kept their eye on the big picture. They didn't need the distraction of the logistics of their mission. I mean, they had to get food, and that's very important. They had to get Jesus to eat the food that they went and got, all while worried about the reputation of the church. I mean, nervous about what will the people think once they hear that Jesus was talking to a Samaritan woman alone, a woman with a reputation. I mean, are you concerned more about the future of the church or the individual who is hurting in the pew beside you? Or maybe you can identify with the Pharisees who were trying to protect the integrity and the reputation of the church. I mean, they felt God called, and they felt in their heart that their mission was to keep the status quo in the church. It was about process. It was about protecting. It was about guarding. but all the while thirsting for something more satisfying than they have. And some of us don't like to do this, and it can get out of hand if we go too far. But maybe you can identify with Jesus. Jesus, who didn't care that teachers or rabbis did not speak to women alone. Jesus, who didn't care about race as Jews and as Samaritans do not speak to one another. Jesus, who at this holy, sacred spot, Jacob's Well, cared more about a person who was hurting, more about a person who was rejected, more about a person who was criticized and gossiped about and was in true need. Jesus, the Messiah, God's Son, the holiest of individuals who ever walked this planet, cared more for the one at the well than the opinions of the rest. And Jesus cares more about what we think of ourselves than what the world thinks of us. Last night, Kelly, Will, and I were walking out of an establishment. And like most of us do, we were wrapped up in our own conversation. I don't even know what it's about. But there, it's a cliche, but literally there sat on the bench was a homeless person. And as I walked by, he mumbled something to me and reached into his pocket and held something out. And I was in conversation and really didn't register, and I don't hear well anyway. And we got three or four steps or probably 30 feet past him, and he didn't say anything else. And it registered me. I guess God gave me a clear thing, because he just said, I only have a little bit of change to get something to eat. He didn't say, could you help me? He didn't say, can I have a dollar? He just said, I only have a little bit of change, and he was showing me the change. So I didn't have any money, so I took Will's wallet and took the cash out of Will's wallet and just went back and said, here, you know, give me something to eat. And it was him that said, God bless you. It was him that gave me the biggest hug that I needed more than anything in the world, especially right now. And I was just too preoccupied. And sometimes we're just too preoccupied to notice the woman at the well. And it's not that I'm a hero or a bad thing. It's that God woke up me out of this superiority of thinking that my problems were bigger than all of your problems. And if it was just for a moment, the few dollars that I didn't even have that I stole from my 17-year-old son that I gave to him, if that could make his night better just for a moment, then I think we all can learn something from that. I know I did. And maybe in this exchange, and maybe it's the exchange that I had last night, and maybe it's an exchange you have, or maybe it's the exchange that we hear about Jesus at the well, that maybe we need to give up some stuff. Maybe we need to give up our superiority. Because in the eyes of God, the man sitting outside a restaurant on a bench with just his bike and his possessions, in the eyes of God, is no more, no less than what I have accomplished in my life. And maybe at the end of the day, each of us are the woman at the well. And our deepest need is to be accepted and to be loved and to be valued, even when all of those around us reject us. And we have the scars, and we remember the pain of rejection. And each of us has a thirst that only Christ can fulfill in us. A thirst that never comes back once it's quenched. And we miss that. We miss that if we're not willing to give up our superiority and humble ourselves at the well of our Savior. Will you pray with me? Gracious and wonderful God,